guys, it's been a while. We had Labor Day weekend to get through, and fall semester for me started on my doctoral program, so I feel like I've been neglecting you a little bit, but hey, back to work. So I was thinking I would talk today about self-care, but I'm going to save that for another day because right now I'm not very good at practicing it. But I want to talk to you today about relationships and bipolar disorder because it's a tough one. You know, when we're learning to control our disorder, our moods, pick up the pieces of things that and people that we left shattered in the wake of our initial diagnosis, it can be challenging. Some people don't understand it, so there's distance that's created. Sometimes you kind of have to learn to clean house and figure out what people are worth keeping and what people aren't worth keeping. And that can be a difficult decision. You know, for me, the beginning of my journey with mental illness, we completely shrouded it in secrecy. We kept it quiet for numerous reasons, which were all completely valid at the time. We had no idea in the beginning what was wrong. We thought I was just a complex case of postpartum depression that needed some ECT, you know, and maybe that was just would get my neurotransmitters jump started and working properly. But you know, in the subsequent months, you know, these bizarre behaviors started creeping in. We had young children that we had to protect and not let it, what I was doing, affect them. We had to not let them see the storm that was going on inside my brain. We had my professional reputation to try and protect. And we were trying to, you know, integrate into a new community. So there was a lot going on. So it was natural that we stayed quiet and we stayed to ourselves. We kept our circle small, we kept it tight, and only a few friends were allowed in to bring joy versus even serve as a confidant. You know, they were just there for pleasure. But when the knowledge of mental illness goes public, be it, you know, your personal choice, an accidental leak, or a less than private display of symptoms, as it can happen sometimes, it's often said that one finds out who's gonna stand by them, remaining true, and who's gonna walk away. You know, you tend to find out, you know, your old circle, your new circle. And sometimes you're better for it that way. And, you know, I found out after the wake of my bipolar disorder, the diagnosis, that my new circle was even smaller than the one I started with. It consisted of family, some friends from, you know, at the time, my kindergarten, I mean, when I went to kindergarten, some friends from graduate school, and just a few friends in my new rural town. And I wasn't gonna give any of them up for the world. They were there, they had reached out, they texted me, they celebrated special days with me, and they all knew with a single look when my brain wasn't okay. And they were completely incapable of anything but love. But does that mean it hurts any less on the days when you recognize that someone walks away? Someone you care about, someone you invested time with, someone that you laughed with, that you may not have spoken to in some time, but as the saying goes, good friends are like stars. You don't always see them, but you know they're always there. So needless to say, I'm realistic enough to know that, you know, there's been people who have chosen to walk away in the face of my bipolar disorder, and some I metaphorically was like, don't let the door hit you in the ass on the way out. But some crept quietly away, and I probably still don't even notice, to be honest. But sometimes the absence stings, it hurts. I know there's been a few people I've cried over, and I don't remember the very first time I cried over a person. I don't know how long they were gone. But it was just kind of like the realization, like, oh, they didn't quit social media. I was defriended. Ouch. And to me, it was kind of like, oh, who does that when there's a mute button? You actually defriended someone? And I got defriended, but my husband was kept on as a friend. And it was like, oh, I wasn't worthy of a hello. I understood finally why texts for like coffee or lunch went unanswered or plans got canceled last minute. So I just quit trying after a time. And this was by the only person at that point who was the only non-family member that we let visit me in the hospital when I was like down and out, and it hurt. And people change. I get that. I do. We grow. We evolve. We're busy with children, commitments. But, you know, my heart doesn't change. My brain chemistry can't help the changes it made. You don't have to be my friend. And I don't have to know the specifics why. But you just have to understand sometimes that you hurt me. And it's going to happen to all of us at some point. It's going to happen again. To me, even. And that's okay. It's part of life. It's part of evolving as a person. It's part of figuring out how we want that circle to look like and be. And heck, we're gonna be 80 and still figuring out these circles and what they should be. Relationships evolve. And sometimes you're gonna be the one who's responsible for why it evolved, and sometimes you're not. But that's the nature of this disorder. It helps you figure out who your friends are, who your friends aren't. There's another saying I like: you're not friends, you're not enemies, you just evolve into some strangers with some memories. And you eventually come to the conclusion that that's okay. And I promise you it'll sting a little less one day. But that's my scoop on relationships with bipolar. They're complex, and they will never stop being complex. Just find your tribe, stick with them, and they won't let you down. That I do promise you. Till next time, kiddos. As always, if you like what you hear and see, please like, share, and subscribe to Bipolar and Me. I'm Anne, and I will see you next time. Take care.